In November 1918, General Pershing, America's victorious commander in the Great War, came home from Europe a hero. The America which welcomed its army back in triumph had prospered from the war. It was now the world's richest country. But for both Britain and America, the end of one conflict marked the beginning of another. No longer comrades in arms, the two countries were about to become rivals in peace. As the gunfire on the battlefields of Europe died away, the first shots were being fired in a new war for the domination of world trade. The first of many commercial battles was fought in the new expanding field of communications. During the war, the American General Electric Corporation had developed powerful radio alternators which could transmit thousands of miles. In 1919, they agreed to sell them to the British company Marconi, who planned to build an imperial chain of radio stations linking the British Empire. On hearing of the proposal, President Wilson dispatched a naval aide, Admiral Bullard, to New York to prevent Britain acquiring the equipment she wanted. Bullard set up a meeting at the New York headquarters of General Electric with Owen Young, one of the heads of the corporation. He said that he'd come with a secret message from President Wilson. Wilson had told him that he believed that in the years ahead, the control of communications would be all important. Britain already dominated the seas. She must not be allowed to dominate worldwide communications as well. The president wanted General Electric to keep hold of the alternators and on no account sell them to Britain. And what's more, if they'd set up a company to rival Marconi, the US Navy would give them a guaranteed monopoly of all their worldwide radio signals. Young got the message. Within a matter of months, GE had set up the Radio Corporation of America, RCA as it's known, and this is its first headquarters building, crowned with the symbols of power and energy and lightning. Fighting men had been promised a home fit for heroes after the war. But in reality, they faced unemployment and hardship. Unlike America, Britain had paid dearly for her victory. In the early 1920s, slump spread through the industrial heartlands. But working people found one escape from the gloom.
We had nothing to do at all down there. Of evening, living in a very dark-looking place, you know, a small mining village. Everything down there seemed black. When I went into the picture house, they used to leave all the doors open to let the light in because there was no electricity. And then when the films come on, all the doors were shut. So, of course, then you were in complete darkness again. And then all the screen would light up. And then you'd see all these marvellous American films. They just lit up the screen. I used to think to myself how lucky, you know, some people were to be like that.
When I saw these films, I imagined Pasadena and California. The name, of course, came through the song, Home in Pasadena. But the name Pasadena was a lovely name, I thought, and so was California. It was musical. And I thought, these are great. That must be a lovely place to live.
Pasadena, home where grass is greener.
I saw life in America as a classless society, for you could rise to become anything.
And orange feet in the breeze.
In this promised land, the skies were always blue, blue all the time with a few white clouds, and we saw the long avenues with the palm trees lining on either side, and the houses, big houses, set back from the road with the lovely lawns in front, and the porch where the people could sit out in the summertime and sip their mint juleps or whatever they did. I thought, that must be what Pasadena's like, a form of life that was far beyond anything we knew.
America soon conquered the screen. By 1925, 90% of all films seen in Britain had been made in America. In the famous silent film Sunrise, a simple country boy is seduced by a modern city girl. She offers him a vision of a new life where dreams of plenty come true. Every week, millions of Britons shared this vision, more thrilling than anything their own country had to offer in the years after the war.
What the British saw on their screens in the early 20s was the enticing picture of America starting to enjoy her new wealth. But it was a fantasy, light years away from their own experience. After the war, the Americans had turned their back on Europe and left really no trace behind them. There were Americans, though, who thought that the time had come for their country to break out of this old isolation, to come and compete in world markets, to try and take over the role that Britain had held at the end of the 19th century, of being the world's largest trading nation. Among the most influential of them was a man who was to become president of the United States, Herbert Hoover. In 1921, he'd just been appointed Secretary of Commerce, and in one of the first pronouncements of his new office, he boldly proclaimed his policy. Just as England has been the center of world trade, he said, so now the United States will assume and maintain international economic leadership.
I think Mr. Hoover felt that, the chief, as we call him, Herbert Hoover, felt that there was an opportunity after World War I for a crusade or for a procedure to venture into the world, which he was aware of, but the American people were not, largely because of their absence of contact with the world as a whole. He saw an opportunity then to inherit what Britain had maintained for a century or two throughout the world by themselves. The dominance and, or perhaps better stated, as the service to the world in supplying needed goods. Perhaps to pick up the torch that Britain had perforce been required to drop during World War I, while they had much more serious business to attend to, and which we then were somewhat the beneficiary, and hopefully to develop throughout the world a great economic presence, and with economic, of course, political power, hopefully for the good.
Hoover moved fast. Within 6 months, the Department of Commerce had expanded 20 times. Each industry had its own bureau, responsible for promoting American exports. The challenge was to break through into world trade.
Hoover made no bones about wanting America to become the richest country the world had ever seen, but it wasn't entirely for selfish reasons. Like President Wilson when he took America into the Great War, Hoover believed that the United States had a moral duty to use her strength to reform the old world. And he believed the way of doing it was through trade. If there could be economic cooperation instead of the rivalries of the old empires, then there was a chance of avoiding another war. But first, America had to prise open the door into these markets, of which the most powerful was Britain and her empire. It's no coincidence that one of the first of the trade bureaus set up by Hoover dealt with the movie industry. Hoover believed that American films would sell American goods. His allies were the people who came week after week to cinemas like this. British people dreaming American dreams.
Thank you. I used to look on all things American with starry eyes. So when I heard these American shoes had got into this shop in Tottenham Court Road, which was quite a long way from Bow, I decided to go and get a pair. But when I got to the shop for these American shoes, there was a queue. And I'd never seen a queue in my life before, and I don't think anybody else had. But I went in and I tried on these shoes. They looked beautiful. They were patent, which meant they shone. And if you had them on, everybody knew you had a pair of American shoes on, because nobody else was making them except Americans. Everything that came from America at that time was good. I won't say it's still good, but it was then. You sort of had the idea that if it came from America, it had to be good. It was good.
It wasn't long before the manufacturers of the products seen in the films started arriving in Britain. In 1927, Max Factor opened his first shop in London, selling what became known as the American look.
Film star makeup came as an absolute revolution, of course, to this country. They'd already got to know it a bit in America, and then suddenly Max Factor was on the doorstep here and in the shops, and with the most wonderful advertising campaign imaginable. In every paper and magazine you picked up, this little coupon that was open for everybody to fill in and send off and get their Max Factor chart, you see, which was a film star chart virtually. And this revolutionized makeup. Nothing of this had ever been done before, and here it was suddenly available to you to go and buy in the shops.
I'd be lost without my glow bay, because without clogging my pores, it allows my skin to breathe just as though it weren't there and keeps my makeup intact for hours. This is very important to all of us women, because the only time that we're not on parade is the time we spend in front of our dressing tables, and sometimes not even then.
What have people had before?
This, and they probably put that in a powder box like that and plonked it on their face, and that virtually was all some women used.
And now my lipstick.
As long as it was a town that had a chemist's shop, you could get it.
And it worked?
And it worked. Of course it worked, because the girls and the women of that town were going to the cinema every week. And of course it worked, and it was the cosmetics of the stars. That's how we advertised, the cosmetics of the stars. It was glamour, and it was American.
American products were promoted by American marketing techniques. The chain store was appearing in the British High Street, and soon traditional British shopkeepers began to complain.
My father was very bitter against Woolworths because my mother's people all had a hardware or tool shops in Sheffield, or they were cutlers, or they all had to do with steel. That trade was taken over by Woolworths. Woolworths really did a lot of harm in Sheffield.
St. George's Day, 1924. Through the grey, cool spring morning, King George and Queen Mary drive in carriages from Windsor to Wembley, the opening of the British Empire Exhibition. It is an exhibition built and collected on a scale of unprecedented grandeur. No less than £12 million have been spent on the erection of the building, and another £12 million on the exhibits, representing all the industry and the art, all the races and creeds and institutions that come under the British flag. And on this morning of April the 23rd, 1924, 100,000 people salute George V, King of the United Kingdom and all the dominions beyond the seas, Emperor of India.
On the fringes of the exhibition were new ways of having fun, but even here, at the heart of British imperialism, it seemed no longer possible to keep America out.
My parents took we children to the British Empire exhibition in 1924. And when we got there, the first thing I saw was a giant helter-skelter. First time new from America. And there was an American wearing a top hat and stars and stripes, and he was saying, come inside the fun fair. My father said, no, because it shouldn't be allowed in a British Empire exhibition. He was a very strong British Empire man. he thought that with so many people out of work, ex-servicemen particularly, they shouldn't have had anything on show that was American.
For all the display of confidence at Wembley in 1924, Britain was in trouble. The pioneer of the Industrial Revolution was losing her way. It was no longer possible for her to thrive on the captive customers of her old industries. The American historian Charles Beard wrote, "England sits enthroned amid her empire, feverishly searching for new markets, hoping to keep the machinery turning and profits flowing, while American competition presses harder and harder upon the merchants of London, Manchester, and Liverpool. The Victorian age has closed, and those who are whistling to keep up their courage and deceive their neighbours merely succeed in hoodwinking themselves." The new pioneers were Americans, men like Henry Ford, inventor of the mass-produced motor car. In this private film, commissioned by Ford, he's seen on holiday with two fellow entrepreneurs, Harvey Firestone, the millionaire tire manufacturer, and Thomas Edison, founder of the giant General Electric. These men were the creators of the modern age. But they found Britain, with her control of many of the world's raw materials, increasingly blocking their progress. They resolved to challenge her head-on. The first and most daring assault was made by Harvey Firestone. In the mid-20s, Akron in Ohio had become the center of rubber tire manufacture in the United States. As automobile production boomed, factories like Firestone and Goodyear became the world's biggest consumers of rubber, most of it grown in British colonies in the Far East. In 1924, a glut led Britain to cut back production, and the price rose tenfold. Harvey Firestone was outraged.
The fact that they controlled the source of rubber meant they controlled the price, and the price got outrageously high. So Mr. Firestone, when he found out what was happening, he pounded on the table, said, "I won't stand for that."
And Dad said, "Well, the motoring public in America is never going to have that again, as far as I'm concerned. I'm going to try and do something about it." So he went down to the government and other places and said, "I think Americans should produce their own rubber."
Firestone found an ally in Secretary of Commerce Herbert Hoover. Hoover had already mounted a propaganda campaign against Britain's control of the rubber market. In a speech to tire executives from Akron, he warned that the American consumer was being trapped by maneuver for British imperial advantage, and told them America must retaliate by finding alternative supplies. Firestone took up his challenge.
He got a lot of good technical rubber men and sent them all around the world to look for a place that they thought would be suitable and the best to buy rubber, where we could get land, where you could get land to do it and all.
Firestone's men found him an ideal spot, the country of Liberia on the west coast of Africa. To the north of the capital, Monrovia, was 1,000,000 square acres of land, ideal for rubber planting.
In 1925, Firestone came to Liberia. Fearful of the monopoly Europe held with its domination of the Far Eastern plantations, they eagerly sought a new land that could grow rubber. Here was abundant rainfall. Here was a soil that for centuries had proved its ability to support tree crops. And here were a government and a people seeking a solution to self-improvement. There were no blueprints for these pioneering rubber growers as they established contact with the village people.
But Firestone was not the only one with designs on Liberia. The country had been founded by American philanthropists as a homeland for freed African slaves. And the American black nationalist Marcus Garvey, founder of the United Negro Improvement Association, wanted to settle there too. Garvey had been negotiating with the Liberian government to come to Liberia with 500,000 followers.
Hundreds of acres of land were ceded to us as for development. And there was no question about it. We thought that the thing was sealed until forces in the United States of America, the Firestone interests and others, they got together with Herbert Hoover, who was then the Secretary of Commerce, protecting the interests of American business. Our problem started then.
The Liberian government were anxious to raise loans and investment from American banks, but reluctant to put their country in Firestone's hands. Firestone, knowing the determination of the American government to outmaneuver the British, turned to the president for help. Confidential State Department cables reveal the pressure now put on Liberia. They offered military assistance and advisors to help handle Firestone's investment, but warned Liberia of the dangers of refusing. On the 22nd of May, 1925, the Secretary of State was quite blunt about it. It would be impossible to raise any loan in the United States on security which could be offered by Liberia unless there is to be the extensive development contemplated in the Firestone contracts.
America did not and does not want the physical expansion of an empire as England. But they won't close their eyes to industrial, commercial empires. Wherever the American money is, there goes the flag.
It was in 1926 that the bush was cleared and rubber planted. From these tiny seeds grew the world's largest rubber plantation. It has been Firestone's success with rubber that has caught the country's imagination.
The prices went down. As a result, we have had ever since then a price structure which was supply and demand and not controlled by any one country.
Britain.
The Liberian experiment was a striking example of the lengths to which America was prepared to go to break Britain's stranglehold on world trade. But it was by no means unique. During the 1920s, American companies bought up British interests in raw materials right round the world, everything from tin and copper to manganese and nitrate. Americans with plenty of money to spend were determined that their expansion shouldn't be held back by Britain. Though America was the world's richest country, the British Empire was by no means on her knees. Britain ruled over a fifth of the Earth's surface, and to protect her interests, she stopped trading competitors getting in by putting up tariff barriers or duties on anyone trying to sell within this magic circle. Thrusting American businessmen soon found a way around that one too. In order to avoid paying the tariffs, they started operating from inside them. They began to set up companies to produce from the very heart of the British Empire.
Dagenham can be described by an amazing mass of figures.
In 1928, Henry Ford began building the largest car plant in the world outside America, on the River Thames at Dagenham.
Well, the Ford Dagenham factory is the only one in Europe that manufactures from raw material to finished product. Actually, both the figures and the factory are too vast to be able to give anything but a skeleton.
Fords were determined to expand their share of the British car market. Cars built in America and imported to Britain paid a 33% tariff, but these cars made in Britain had no extra duty imposed on them. The factory adopted the new methods of mass production pioneered by Ford in America. A line of cars moving in stately procession through the works, with each job timed to the nearest second. Ford was followed by other American companies. Some simply bought up ailing British companies and used American methods to rejuvenate them.
I came over to England in 1930 because Procter & Gamble Company of Cincinnati had just bought a small English soap company in Newcastle upon Tyne, England. Thomas Hadley and Company had very little modern technology in soap making.
Their methods were rather elementary. They even packaged products by hand. We had to go to mechanical packaging, of course. It took about 3 years to make the company profitable. I think they, as to use an American expression, pulled up their socks considerably.
In 1928, the same year that Ford started at Dagenham, his friend Harvey Firestone, speaking by radio from Ohio, opened his first British factory at Brentford in West London.
The British Empire was the biggest single market Firestone had for export of tires made in the USA. That was the first plant that Firestone made overseas in Britain. The plant shipped tires in all of the parts of the British Empire because if they would want to ship from the USA to South Africa, for instance, or to India, their tariffs would be different, considerably different, than if you would be shipping from the mother country. So it opened up the whole British Empire, in a sense, when we put the factory there.
In response to the American invasion, British companies launched a counterattack, extolling the virtues of traditional production methods.
First with a car within reach of modest means. First with nationwide service facilities. And now, first with specialization. No mass production here. No hurly-burly of the quicker and cruder methods of production. Every car built as carefully, thoroughly, deliberately, as if it were the only one in the works.
Oh, my carpet! Oh, my carpet! Oh, my carpet! Don't forget! With a Hoover,
yes, a Hoover,
we will be the blighters yet.
When the American Hoover Company arrived in Britain, they promised the housewife a revolution in the home, and they promoted it by revolutionary means.
Hoover brought all their salesmen down here to a holiday camp on the coast to give them a concentrated course of sales indoctrination, because they had mass production running at a new factory in Perivale, and they had to have the mass sales to satisfy the output from that factory. And selling was quite new in this country. Up until then, people would go into a shop and they would ask for whatever they wanted. They'd be served over the counter. And there was no hard selling as such. Well, here you were taking a product into the home and you were persuading the housewife that she really needed this to help her do her housework. So you had to train this man to put over all the essential parts of this, as a trained salesman would do. So he learned it parrot fashion. They had meetings every week. They were just singing to themselves to hype themselves up and reassure themselves that they were the best. They had the best product.
The camp town ladies sing the song.
Hoover, Hoover.
The camp town ladies sing the song.
Hoover all the day.
So the salesmen were under great pressure to sell these things, but there was resistance from the housewife. At the same time, the company was all the time pressurizing the man to sell. And one of the biggest obstacles he had to overcome, once he got in to give the demonstration and convince the woman she needed this appliance, was to get her to find a deposit. One example I can tell you about is where the salesman persuaded the woman who wanted the vacuum cleaner to let him take the headstone off her husband's grave and take it down to the local mason and sell it and keep the money for the deposit on her vacuum cleaner.
Day is ending, birds are wending back to the shelter of...
By the late 1920s, Britain was succumbing to America's spell. It had become smart to do as America did, to dress and dance and drink in the American fashion. It was Britain's jazz age.
When whippoorwills call, when whippoorwills call, and evening is
dying,
I hurry to my blue heaven. A turn to the right,
a turn to the right,
a little white line,
a little...
That's it.
whole cinema. And it was very, very nice place, very elegant. Probably one of the most elegant restaurants I played in.
What did you play there? What sort of music?
Oh, sophisticated numbers. Nice numbers.
Where did they come from, these tunes?
Well, America. Nearly all the tunes. I think I only remember one good tune that was done by an Englishman was Your Blase, which didn't get terribly popular, but it was up to their standard.
But why wasn't it English music that was played there?
I don't know, because they didn't seem to be able to write that kind of music easily, you know. It was more or less nearly all American. It was the tunes that you could come out of the place singing and all that sort of thing. That's the catch, you know, to be able to imprint it on the public's mind so much that they can't get rid of it.
The music, of course, was absolutely wonderful. The Americans seemed to know what you wanted. If you had a partner, the American music provided the sort of feeling that there's nothing wrong in getting close together and putting your arm on somebody's shoulder and your hand up properly, because that meant you could dance well. And if you could dance well, you were out of the humdrum.
American music was heard everywhere, from popular dance halls to chic London nightclubs, modelled on the speakeasies of Chicago and New York.
The Bag of Nails was a place where we could go and play jazz. We'd still be playing American tunes, but they'd be the jazz tunes that the jazz boys in America used.
America's growing influence in Britain met with a chorus of disapproval. Teachers and churchmen complained that British values were being undermined. A Tory MP protesting in the House of Commons quoted from a popular newspaper. The sad truth is that the majority of our population now talk America, think America, dream America. They have, to all intent and purpose, become temporary American citizens. The blame for all this was put on American films. To limit their influence, Parliament introduced a Film Act. In future, a quota of all films shown in Britain would have to be made in Britain. But American filmmakers weren't so easily seen off. They set up their own British studios to make what they cynically called quota quickies.
Quota quickies were made by American companies to satisfy the British law, which had decided that a certain proportion of pictures shown in the British market were made by British film producers. So the Americans decided to satisfy the law by making those pictures in Britain. They had no intention of showing them in America.
What were they like?
Fortunately, I saw very few of them.
Well, I'm going to tell you. I believe in Reggie, but he's been allowed to drift away his life. No one has ever given him any go, any pep.
Pep?
Yes.
Why waste money on a picture which is only going to be seen by a limited number of local people, so to speak?
Excuse me. Opening time.
Quota quickies were made on the cheap. Lazy Bones, a typical quickie, was filmed at night. The sets borrowed from films being made during the day. The actors were moonlighting too, arriving after they'd finished their evening's performance in the London theatre.
They actually gave a show on in the West End, Then they got into a car and were brought down to Twickenham. Then, because the union insisted on it, everybody immediately sat down to an enormous dinner, roast beef and potatoes and all the right things to eat when you're just going to play a romantic scene.
Will you marry me, Kitty?
Well, Reggie, I don't know.
It was a real killer from the point of view of an ambitious young director like I was.
Quota quickies became notorious. Many were shown in empty cinemas to the cleaners, simply to fulfill the quota. Newspapers complained that the Americans were destroying the British film industry.
I don't think it was destroying the British film industry. Dominating, yes. It was dominating for the simple reason that the pictures the Americans were making appealed more to the British movie-going public than their own pictures were. So in that respect, they were dominating. Do I feel guilty of that? Why should I feel guilty?
In 1928, Herbert Hoover exchanged the Department of Commerce for the presidency of the United States. In less than 10 years, he'd seen an unprecedented expansion of American trade. In the process, Britain was being replaced as the main trading nation in many parts of the world. But Hoover saw dangers ahead. He feared that the idealism, the desire to reform the world which had motivated him, were being replaced by a narrow commercialism. Size, wealth, and power were not enough, he warned in the first speech of his campaign. As our problems grow, so do our temptations grow, to venture away from those principles upon which our republic was founded. The same year saw Britain elect its first socialist government, with Ramsay MacDonald leading the Labour cabinet. It inherited the problems of an empire in decline and the challenge from America. The new Prime Minister was warned by his predecessor, Stanley Baldwin, the American money power is trying to get control of some of the natural resources of the empire. They are working like beavers. Even as Baldwin spoke, the beavers were hard at work. One of America's giant industrial conglomerates, General Electric, was plotting a secret attempt to buy up the entire electrical industry in Britain. There was a lot of money to be made out of electricity in the 20s. Modernization, electrical products were all the rage. And General Electric already owned one big British company, British Thomson Houston. They made everything from electric light bulbs to turbines. But as competition in the market began to grow, they worried that their profits were going to be eroded. And they looked at some of their rivals. Their eye fell on their principal competitor here in Britain, Metropolitan Vickers, whose headquarters were these huge plants here in Manchester. The chairman of General Electric, Owen Young, decided that the moment had come for what he called rationalization.
He thought it could be more profitable if the industry were rationalized, because he saw four competing units over there, none of which was making the profit it should. And he saw possibilities in uniting them that would make the whole thing more profitable. In other words, Britain would then be in the place that it belonged. That's the way he put it in talking to his friends, but arranged by America.
Young worked closely with his managing director, Gerard Swope. On the 12th of February, 1928, Swope instructed his subsidiary, British Thomson Houston, BTH, to buy up Metropolitan Vickers. But as soon as the shares were acquired, they were transferred into the name of a millionaire British industrialist, Dudley Docker. To all except those in the know, it looked as though Docker had bought up Metropolitan Vickers, one in the eye for the American electrical industry. The deal was arranged in strict secrecy. Coded telegrams from BTH reported every move back to Swope in New York. The head of BTH confirmed that he still had the shares, though they were in Docker's name. Docker says that no one knows I have them. The rumors will soon die down. Swope wrote to Docker thanking him for his help in the subterfuge and giving him £50,000 for all his assistance.
I can only guess at why Swope did it. And I suspect that it was because he was fed up with British resistance to this scheme that we thought would be such a boon to Britain, British industry. And finally decided that, all right, if you had to disguise it, and Docker would do it, better let him do it. Docker had been bought, so to speak.
But Swope and Young had more work for Docker to do. Thinking that growing anti-Americanism could damage their original company, BTH, they decided to pretend to sell that to Docker as well. In November 1928, Docker duly made an offer for General Electric's shares in BTH, paid for them in cash provided by General Electric, and emerged as the apparent boss of a new British conglomerate, AEI. It looked to the British as though the American invasion, as it was being called, was being repulsed. No one could guess that most of the electrical industry now belonged to General Electric of America, and no one would tell, certainly not Dudley Docker.
He was a man who had the reputation of being very much concerned with control, British control of British industry. And this would have been had this been public knowledge, it would have been construed as a sellout on his part.
Even as General Electric's scheme was being implemented, some businessmen in Chicago were planning an assault on another part of the British electricity industry. They wanted to buy up all the power stations in Britain. Chicago, at the end of the 1920s, was the model of a modern city. Its industry, its commerce, and its transport systems all ran on cheap electricity. Hundreds of small power stations had been taken over and joined together in a citywide grid system to cut costs and guarantee supplies. Britain was ripe for the same treatment. London alone had a mass of different power stations putting out different voltages. To end the chaos, Parliament had proposed a national grid. Two Chicago businessmen, Harley Clark and Samuel Insull, saw their opportunity, and Insull sent an engineer to London to investigate.
I was quite surprised at London. There was no grid system. There was no means in England at that time of any great system connecting one community to another, and each one seemed to have their own little electrical system. I wondered how they could supply industrial power and how they could, industrial production. The British seemed quite contented in their way. There was London with all of its smoke and traffic, and they were very orderly about it. They queued up to the buses, and it wasn't the helter-skelter running that you see in New York and in Chicago. But they must have realized sooner or later that in order to catch up with the world on production of goods and things of that nature, they needed a vast amount of electric power.
Insull and Clark began to buy up power stations in Britain. Insull did it openly, but Clark in secret. He set up a company called the Greater London and Counties Trust. By 1929, it controlled 54 power companies, making it one of the largest suppliers of electricity in Britain. With British directors and an eminent Conservative MP as chairman, it was made to look like a British company. At board meetings, however, the real owner was in control. When rumours spread that the company was American-owned, Clark persuaded the former Lord Chancellor, Lord Birkenhead, to become chairman. Birkenhead gave reassuring interviews, explaining that Clark was only there to provide financial backing. The organisation, he said, is British. When he bought the companies, Clark put British politicians on the board. Why did he do that?
Very common practice and very worthwhile. You need local support, integration and so on. If you go to drill a silver mine in Mexico, you add some Mexicans. It's just done worldwide, has been for centuries. You weren't able to handle silver miners very well if you didn't have somebody there, a native, to talk to them. Now, he might have been a well-heeled native, but he understood the language.
In the 20s, the electrical industry in Britain was expanding. New power stations and the factories that went with them were being built along London's river and around every major city in Britain. But in 1929, the truth about electricity came out. The American involvement was far greater than anyone had suspected. First, it emerged that General Electric of America, not content with what they'd already bought, had acquired over half the last remaining big electrical company, which in a panic tried to deny the Americans their voting rights. Then, just 2 weeks later, the facts about AEI came out, that it was wholly American-owned. And finally, the electricity commissioners in charge of Britain's grid system revealed that the Americans were buying up Britain's power stations too, and warned that they were siphoning off the profits from Britain back to the United States. America Conquers Britain was the title of a bestseller at the time. Its American author concluded, "We were Britain's colony once. She will be our colony before she's done. Not in name, but in fact. But we shan't make Britain's mistake. Too wise to govern the world, we shall merely own it. Nothing can stop us. Nothing. Until our financial empire rots at its heart, as empires have a way of doing. What chance has Britain against America?" In 1929, a speculative madness seized American society. The stock market had boomed, and using borrowed money, shareholders bought and sold and bought again in a market that seemed to be fixed in an upward spiral. A few wise heads wondered what would happen if it went into reverse. Investors and the banks who had lent to them would be ruined, and the industries which were fueling America's prosperity would be in jeopardy. On Black Thursday, October the 24th, 1929, the panic began. Shares started falling, and the nightmare came true.
It was one of disbelief to begin with. Then when the men began jumping from the skyscrapers in Manhattan, it was too slowly, only slowly driven home on people in America, much more slowly, of course, on people outside America, that this was a radical, recession is too mild a word, a catastrophe. This was the greatest economic power in the world, both in terms of agricultural produce and in terms of manufacturing, and it was having its national income halved and even more in a matter of 12 months.
As far as people like myself are concerned, when that happened, it wasn't until the 1930s and 1931 and 32 that really the depression began to bite. And the songs, for example, "Buddy, Can You Spare a Dime?" That was a song everybody was singing about 1931, 32. And that was quite a change from Home in Pasadena type of music. Here we had men going about the streets saying, "Buddy, can you spare a dime? Once I built a railroad, made it run against time. Now that the job is finished, buddy, can you spare a dime?" That kind of thing. "Once I built a tower," this was a skyscraper, "I built a tower to the sky, brick and rivet and lime. Once I built a tower, now it's done. Buddy, can you spare a dime?" That was a kind of America that began to get into our consciousness.
The shockwaves of the stock market crash in America hit a Britain already struggling to cope with economic depression. Millions of dollars invested by America in Britain during the 1920s were called back home. By December 1930, 2.5 million Britons were out of work. In the spring of 1931, the May Committee, set up to investigate the economy, reported that the government was running a dangerously high deficit. It recommended cuts in public spending, including unemployment benefits. Confidence in sterling crumbled. In an effort to support the pound, MacDonald tried to raise loans from foreign bankers, in particular from America. He turned to the famous American banker, J.P. Morgan, who'd saved Britain once before by raising loans during the Great War. But Morgan replied that times had changed. It would be impossible to raise loans in America unless the British government tightened its belt as the May Committee and the Bank of England had asked, and cut unemployment benefit. On the 24th of August 1931, the British Cabinet, torn apart by this demand, resigned. Ramsay MacDonald stayed in office to head a national coalition government which would put through the cuts that had been called for.
Nation is in trouble. The nation is in difficulties. Not permanent trouble and not permanent difficulties. Temporary, purely temporary. Why has it happened? Not because we are weak, because we are not. It has happened because on account of many economic causes, the trade of the world, the whole world, not merely ours, the trade of the whole world has come practically to a standstill.
MacDonald's reassurance was in vain. By the middle of September 1931, it was obvious that the foreign loans had not stopped the run on sterling. Britain now did the unthinkable. She suspended the gold standard, the fixed value of the pound against gold. It was a signal to the world that Britain was no longer the great economic power she claimed to be.
When I came to work first in New York, it was a rather dramatic day because I came to work on a Monday. And on the preceding weekend, the United Kingdom had gone off the gold standard, and there were headlines all across the full extent of the papers about this occurrence on Monday morning. And it was really a startling thing because we'd looked to the pound sterling for years, everything I'd been brought up with. And so when I started, it was with the realization that we were coming into a new era and a new world.
Britain's impression of America also began to change. American films no longer showed a tranquil society, but one becoming more divided and violent.
The picture of America that we built up from the films was this place with these terrific divisions of ways of life. There was a city where there were enormous apartments where rich people lived. And then there was another part where the streets were dark, it was always raining, people were poverty-stricken, there were gangsters and men were put out of work for no reason and their families suffered. I thought that that must be somewhere like Detroit or Chicago, which I'd heard about.
I've just been looking at the paper here and I see that you men came down here to shoot gangsters. What inspired you to do that?
Well, I saw why they'd been shooting up children down here and thought I'd come down and take a crack at them.
Do you think you could spot a gangster, say, two city blocks?
Yes, I think I could.
With the depression in America deepening, President Hoover now set up steep import barriers to protect American industry. Britain replied in kind. The harmony which Hoover had believed American trade would bring to the world now gave way to economic and military rivalry as the European powers headed towards another war. In the chaos that was to come, Britain would once again appeal to America's idealism. But for the moment, the image of America the good was fading.
This dream that I and many, many more boys and girls like me had, this wonderful dream of a land of unlimited opportunity where we could really become something different and better from what we were. No matter what has happened in America since or before that time, for us, that fantasy of Pasadena will never be eroded, so far as I am concerned. And no matter how long I live or how old I become, it would still in my mind the dream of Pasadena, California, can never be eroded or pass out of existence. For me, it's always present and it's always there to fall back on. It's a fantasy, I know, but there it is, a fantasy like a reality, never eroded by time.
An Ocean Apart is made possible in part by British Airways, serving North America to London and beyond. Hanson, a company which has provided basic goods and services since 1964 and attained increased profits, dividends, and earnings per share every year. Hanson, here today, here tomorrow. And by this and other public television stations.